as saying, "Oh, our Lord, we are afraid أن يفرط علينا أو أن يطغى." They were afraid because they had to deal with someone, oppressive people on the face of this earth, Fir'aun. They said, "O Allah, O our Lord, we are afraid that he may be hasty with us, or that he may transgress." Now there's no one on the face of this earth today who can be more oppressive, more tyrannical than Fir'aun at that time. But Allah subhanahu wa jalla wa ala responded to them. Allah subhanahu wa jalla wa ala addressed their fear, addressed their uncertainty, where Allah subhanahu wa jalla wa ala said, "لا تخافا," do not be afraid. "إنني معكما أسمع وأرى," do not be afraid, as I am with both of you. I am listening, I am hearing, and I am watching. Allah subhanahu wa jalla wa ala revealed for them this comfort that Allah subhanahu is with them. And then in the same words, Allah subhanahu wa jalla wa ala not only comforted them, but also spelt out the formula, described an action item that would grant them protection. He said, "إنني أسمع وأرى," surely I am listening and I am watching. In these words, the action item is that if we inculcate this statement that Allah subhanahu wa jalla wa ala is always listening, that Allah subhanahu is always watching, that if we inculcate these statements in our belief, in our psyche, in our behavior, in our actions, in our memory, that Allah subhanahu is always watching us, that Allah subhanahu is always listening to everything we say, that if we do that, we will have no recourse except to avoid Allah's disobedience, because He is watching, He is listening, and thus it would be as the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, احفظ الله يحفظك. Take guard, be on guard in regards to the requirements of Allah subhanahu jalla wa ala. يحفظك. The result is that Allah will protect you and guard you and safeguard your interests. أسمع وأرى is tawheed of Allah subhanahu jalla wa ala. That if we do that in our lives, Allah subhanahu is promising us protection. My dear brothers and sisters, this is not the time for Muslims to be silent. This is not the time for Muslims to hide their Islam. If we have a Rabb that says he is asma'u wa ara, that he is listening and he is watching, this is the time for Muslims to speak about Islam. This is the time for Muslims to clarify the misconceptions that have been propagated against Islam. This is the time for Muslims to take Islam beyond the walls of a masjid and let people know what the true Islam is. There is no need for a Muslim to be defensive. Islam did not do anything wrong. Religions don't kill, people kill. This is exactly what Allah subhanahu jalla wa ala said to Musa and Harun alayhim assalam after he told them that I am with you listening and watching. Allah subhanahu jalla wa ala then told them to go out and take the message to the people. In times of uncertainty and fear, this is exactly the formula that Allah subhanahu has spelt out. Speak to your neighbors. Do not be afraid. Speak to those that you know. Speak to those that you don't know. And clarify this beautiful religion of Islam that has been misunderstood. My dear brothers and sisters, we have doubts that are propagated against Islam. And as Muslims, it's our responsibility to peel away the layers of these doubts from the eyes of the people so they may see Islam for what it is. There is a concerted effort to make Islam look violent. There is a concerted effort to disparage Islam. And if Muslims remain silent, then we cannot blame the so many innocent Americans who are receiving misinformation and then forming thoughts that are negative about Islam. Many things have been said about Islam and our Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And the major reason that this misinformation is allowed to be spread is that this concerted effort has a certain strategy, and that is to take ayat and ahadith out of context. And as a rule of thumb, if there is any ayah that is questionable or the critics are trying to disparage it, the rule of thumb is look at the 10 ayats before and the 10 ayats afterwards. Miraculously, Allah subhanahu wa jalla wa ala has placed the refutation and the answer that will resolve the doubt that the critic has regarding that verse. As a rule of thumb, we will take one example, the hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, which he said about the Jews, فَلَا تَبْدَأُوهُمْ بِالسَّلَامِ. They say, you say, your Prophet is a rahma lil alameen. He is a mercy to the universe, a mercy for the worlds. But yet, your Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam said, do not initiate salam to the Jews. They say, where is the Prophet of peace? As-salam means peace and security. Why was not peace and security extended to the Jews of Medina? Out of context. If we place this hadith in its appropriate context, we can see that these so-called scholars have not made an effort in trying to understand the context of this hadith. The context of the hadith is that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was engaged in the battle of Khandaq, the battle of the trench, where the Quraysh and the Arab tribes all allied to attack Medina, where the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and the Muslims were, and to put an end to Islam once and for all. Now let's backtrack a little bit. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, when he first arrived in Medina, one of the very first things he did was to sign peace treaties with the neighboring communities, including the Jews like Banu Qurayza and Banu Nadir. Now, when in the Battle of Khandaq, when the Quraysh amassed armies to attack Medina, they tempted the Jews and said, come support us, we will finish Islam once and for all. But the Jews were in a predicament. They were in a peace treaty with the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and the Muslims. However, they were not able to withstand that temptation, and they gave in. They gave in. Banu Qurayza offered support. Banu Nadir offered intelligence exposing the positions of the Muslims. All of this while they were under a peace treaty. Now Allah subhanahu wa jalla wa ala made the efforts of the Quraysh to go in vain, and they were not able to cross the trench and invade Medina, so they retreated and left back. The problem now was that these two tribes of the Jews who committed treachery and broke the peace treaty could not move or go back or go anywhere else, because that's exactly where they lived, at the outskirts of Medina. So when the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was done with the battle of Khandaq, Jibreel came to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and told him to march forward. So they went to Banu Qurayza, and the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, إني راكب غدا إلى اليهود فلا تبدأوهم بالسلام. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam then told the Sahaba, he said, tomorrow I will be heading towards the Jews, So do not initiate the salam to them. What does the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam have to tell his companions not to initiate the salam? The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam had to do that because this situation was an exception. Previously, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam had developed and taught and conditioned the companions to say salam to those you know and to those you don't know, Muslim or non-Muslim. So now the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam had to tell them, do not take this etiquette while we are going to the Yahud to retaliate their treachery, and do not give salam. But why? What would have been the big deal if the Muslim said assalamu alaikum? What would have been the big deal if that happened? Here is the wonder of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Because of this treachery, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was going with his companions in arms to retaliate this enemy who has declared war upon the Muslims. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam did not want anyone to offer as-salam, because as-salam meant, as a Muslim, if he gives salam to someone, it means that you are secure. You will receive no harm from a Muslim's tongue, hands, openly or implicitly, that you are completely safe. Now the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam did not want to misrepresent his intention, because he was going to retaliate and did not want to say salam, because he did not want to, his actions to contradict his statements. Allahu Akbar. The word as-salam, just this statement, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam held back. My dear brothers and sisters, if we put true meanings to the words that we say, our condition in the world will improve drastically. When we say assalamu alaikum to each other, let's forget about all the other etiquettes of Islam for a moment. By just saying assalamu alaikum, it means that not a single one of us would be harmed by another. It's impossible that when we meet someone and say assalamu alaikum, and then when he walks away, we could ever slander him. We could ever backbite him. We could ever sit in a gathering where he is being attacked and his reputation is being destroyed. It's impossible. It's antithetical to the behavior and etiquette of Islam and the Muslims. My dear brothers and sisters, when we say I love you for the sake of Allah, what does that mean? When we say assalamu alaikum, what does that mean? What does the love for the sake of Allah require us to do? We say it so easily today, but where are its meanings? The first challenge that comes in a relationship, I love you for the sake of Allah, is out the window. The companions and the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam were a people. When they said something, they meant it. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said what he meant, and he meant what he said. If you say assalamu alaikum and met a Muslim brother, it's impossible that you would cheat him in a business transaction. If you say I love you for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, it's impossible that you would show hatred to this individual. My dear brothers and sisters, not ascribing proper meanings to the words that we say rub off the wrong way to our next generation, our children. They don't know what these words mean. And this is why we find today, for some kids, inshallah, which has a huge meaning, inshallah means maybe. Jazakallahu khairan to them means thank you. That is because they did not see their elders live out the meanings of these words. And then we find that if we don't value these words and its meanings, we treat them insignificantly. We begin a text or a body of an email with Asa, supposedly, assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Sometimes you might get a WRB. We end it with Jack. Jazakallahu khairan. We'll say IA for inshallah. Some may say, what's the big deal? Allah subhanahu jalla wa ala said, وَمَنْ يُعَذِّمْ شَعَائِرَ اللَّهِ فَإِنَّهَا مِنْ تَقْوَى الْقُلُوبِ. Whoever amplifies and sees great the symbols of Allah, it's from the taqwa of their hearts. Sometimes there's nothing important at all in the whole email or the whole text. And the only thing that can give the person a reward is that salam or that jazakullah khairan, and everything else is basically gibberish. But everything else in the emails, in the email is spelt out fully. But when it comes to the words of the adhkar, they're abbreviated. My dear brothers and sisters, this is indicative of our love for these words, which are tied directly to the love of Allah subhanahu jalla wa ala. Hamza al-Kanani, a scholar of hadith, someone who used to narrate hadith and spend a lot of time recording hadith. He would have to write so many hadith. Imagine every time he would write a hadith, he would have to write sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. If anyone should abbreviate, it should have been the hadith scholars. So Hamza al-Kanani one day decided, instead of writing sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he's going to say anin nabi sallallahu alayhi. No abbreviation, just sallallahu alayhi. Because it will take too much time to write over and over wasallam, wasallam, wasallam. Time management. Then Hamza says, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam then came in my dream and said, why do you not complete the salam upon me? Allahu Akbar. Allah subhanahu jalla wa ala said, sallu alayhi wasallimu tasliman. When we give the salam and the salah upon the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, to do it tasliman, completely, fully, not abbreviated. No S-A-W, no S-A, no Saad. It's written sallallahu alayhi wasallam tasliman. This is indicative of our love for Allah subhanahu jalla wa ala and our love for the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam. أقول قولي هذا أستغفر الله لي ولكم ولسائر المؤمنين فإنه غفور رحيم. الحمد لله وحده والصلاة والسلام على من لا نبي بعده أما بعد. Allah subhanahu jalla wa ala speaks about two individuals who owned a large garden. And they were excited that the next morning they were going to harvest their crops and fruits. And they said, وَلَا يَسْتَثْنُونَ. They did not want any poor person or anyone else to get a share of anything that they had. وَلَا يَسْتَثْنُونَ, no exception, nobody, no family, no relative, no poor person, no rich person, no gift for anybody. This harvest the next day is cash, wealth. It's all for us. Al-Baghawi says, وَلَا يَسْتَثْنُونَ. Here also means that they said, tomorrow we're going to harvest our crops and fruits. And they didn't say inshallah. They didn't make that exception. That only if Allah wills, it will happen. The next morning they went and they found their crops and their fruits destroyed. My dear brothers and sisters, our attitude towards the meanings of adhkar are not a small matter. Our businesses could fail. Our relationships can be in trouble. Our communities can suffer if we don't give meaning to these words. It's not that we just save them for the moment. I love you, brother, for the sake of Allah. But that we say it for real and we live up to what those meanings require. If we just do that, just that, I'm not even talking about making tahajjud, fasting every other day, just this, we give meanings to when we say La ilaha illallah. We understand the depth of their meanings. This will change the whole Muslim world. My dear brothers and sisters, Allah subhanahu jalla wa ala talked about people who gave meanings to their words. It changed the laws of physics. Allah subhanahu said, "Inna sakharna al-jibala ma'ahu yusabbihna bil-'ashi wal-ishraq." Allah subhanahu talked about Dawood alayhi salam, that when he made zikr, when he said subhanallah, when he said la ilaha illallah, it was said with such meaning that Allah subhanahu said, "We subdued the mountains that made zikr with him." In the morning, in the late afternoon, وَالطَّيْرَ مَحْشُورَ, and birds in assemblies would come, because Dawood alayhi salam said, Alhamdulillah, the mountains now speak. The birds now make dhikr with Dawood alayhi salam, because he felt their meanings. كُلٌ لَهُ أَوَّاب, each one of them is repeating the dhikr after Dawood alayhi salam. The Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam gave depth to these meanings. When he would walk, the rocks would give him salam, because his salam had meanings. His food would make tasbih. Someone may say, well, these were prophets. Yes, their prophetic depth of the meanings of the words gave them these levels. But for the believers as well, if we give meanings to these words, it can change and do a lot. The Prophet ﷺ spoke about people who are not prophets. He said that they will come towards the end of time and they will be the best of people on earth. In other words, if they were to say Allahu Akbar, there will be so much value in that word, in those words. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam then said about them, فَلَمْ يُقَاتِلُوا بِسِلَاحٍ وَلَمْ يَرْمُوا بِسَهْمٍ قَالُوا لَا إِلَهَ إِلَّا اللَّهُ وَاللَّهُ أَكْبَرُ. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam mentioned that Allah subhanahu, when they will be in battle, will give them victory. How? They will not use any weapon. They will not throw a single arrow. They will say, La ilaha illallah, Wallahu Akbar, and the other side will fall. Allahu Akbar. If we today were to think about what we say, if we give value to our words, the world will give value to Islam and the Muslims. Once we start valuing our words and our azkar, it will affect this whole world's situation amongst the Muslim ummah. Ask Allah subhanahu wa jalla wa ala to make us amongst those who say what we mean and mean what we say. To make us amongst those who understand the depths and the meanings of his adhkar and his words. ربنا آتنا في الدنيا حسنة وفي الآخرة حسنة وقنا عذاب النار. ربنا لا تزغ قلوبنا بعد إذ هديتنا وهب لنا من لدنك رحمة إنك أنت الوهاب. ربنا لا تؤاخذنا إن نسينا وأخطأنا. ربنا ولا تحمل علينا إصرا كما حملته على الذين من قبلنا. ربنا ولا تحملنا ما لا طاقة لنا به. واعف عنا واغفر لنا وارحمنا. أنت مولانا فانصرنا على القوم الكافرين. ربنا تقبل منا إنك أنت السميع العليم. وتب علينا إنك أنت التواب الرحيم. وصلى الله على نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين وسلم. وأقيم الصلاة.
الله أكبر الله أكبر أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله أشهد أن محمد رسول الله حي على الصلاة حي على الفلاح قد قامت الصلاة قد قامت الصلاة الله أكبر الله أكبر لا إله إلا الله.
استووا. Please fill up the rows in front of you first. Stow. Straighten the rows. الله أكبر. الحمد لله رب العالمين الرحمن الرحيم مالك يوم الدين إياك نعبد وإياك نستعين اهدنا الصراط المستقيم صراط الذين أنعمت عليهم غير المغضوب عليهم ولا الضالين آمين. إذا زلزلت الأرض زلزالها وأخرجت الأرض أثقالها وقال الإنسان ما لها يومئذ تحدث أخبارها بأن ربك أوحى لها يومئذ يصدر الناس أشتاتا ليروا أعمالهم فمن يعمل مثقال ذرة خيرا يره ومن يعمل مثقال ذرة شرا يره الله أكبر. سمع الله لمن حمده الله أكبر الله أكبر الله أكبر الله أكبر الحمد لله رب العالمين الرحمن الرحيم مالك يوم الدين إياك نعبد وإياك نستعين اهدنا الصراط المستقيم صراط الذين أنعمت عليهم غير المغضوب عليهم ولا الضالين آمين. القارعة ما القارعة وما أدراك ما القارعة يوم يكون الناس كالفراش المبثوث وتكون الجبال كالعهن المنفوش فأما من ثقلت موازينه فهو في عيشة راضية وأما من خفت موازينه
فأمه هاوية وما أدراك ما هي نار حامية. الله أكبر. سمع الله لمن حمده. الله أكبر. الله أكبر. الله أكبر. الله أكبر. السلام عليكم ورحمة الله. السلام عليكم ورحمة الله. الله أكبر. الله أكبر. استغفر الله. استغفر الله. استغفر الله. السلام عليكم.
السلام عليكم ورحمة الله. بسم الله الحمد لله الصلاة والسلام على رسول الله. I want to tell Sheikh Shakil Humayun, Jazakallahu khairan, and we mean it, right? From the bottom of our heart, Jazakallahu khair. Inshallah ta'ala, Sheikh Shakil will be with us tonight doing a workshop called I Believe. It will start tonight after Isha and will continue tomorrow from 11 to 4. This workshop is about some doubts about the deen that will be clarified inshallah ta'ala. Questions about atheism, jizya, jihad, women in Islam, the marriage of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, all these questions we are bombarded by and we do not know how to answer them. So inshallah ta'ala, come tonight and tomorrow bi-ithnillah, and you will bi-ithnillah get better acquainted with the proper answers inshallah. Brother Junaid.
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah. Again, JazakAllah khairan, Sheikh Ashaqil. I've known for about 20 years from New York, alhamdulillah. Just a few announcements, inshallah. Next weekend is a very busy weekend for Epic, alhamdulillah. Next, on Saturday and then the 19th, with Epic Youth, we have a paintball outing, so all the kids over the age of 16 are encouraged to go. We also have our first annual Epic Sports Appreciation Day, so which will be held at Breckenridge Park, inshallah, after Dhuhr. So, this weekend and next weekend, we're having sports tournaments in cricket, basketball, and volleyball. So if you haven't already registered a team, please go online, inshallah, register a team for the sports tournament, inshallah. Also, next Sunday, the outreach committee is having two events, inshallah. Next Sunday, the 20th, inshallah, after Dhuhr, in partnership with Y Islam, They're having an event for people who are interested in Islam. So we're going to have an open house here at the masjid. So please invite all of your friends and family who are non-Muslim and encourage them to come to have an education on Islam, inshallah. Also, the outreach committee is arranged an Educator Appreciation Day on December 3rd. That is for all of your kids' teachers. It's to kind of appreciate them for what they do, at the same time also educate them regarding what are the principles to be taught in Islam in the classrooms. So inshallah, those are also, next weekend is an ijtima happening in Tyler. The Beagle brothers are having that. So for those who are interested, inshallah, you can find the details on our flyer. ICNA is having their annual Southeast South conference, inshallah, during Thanksgiving weekend. So many speakers are going to be there. We encourage it. It's a nice family event for everybody to go, inshallah. And it will be in Houston. So everybody's encouraged to go. There's a request for dua. Give me 1 second, sorry. There's a brother, Awab. He is 15 years old. He's in the final stage of cancer. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to give him complete ashafa, inshallah, make it a means for his maghfirah dhunub, inshallah. Also, there's a sister, Tanveer Hassan, in Pakistan. She is the mother of a community member of ours. She is also in the last stages. We are asking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to give her, she's very sick, I'm sorry, not last stages, she's very sick. We are asking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to give her a complete ashafa, inshallah, and make this a means for her forgiveness, inshallah, make it an easy time for the family, inshallah, as well. Jazakum Allah khairan, Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.